biology.
Yes, very much welcome again to this class, whereby in this class we are now going to discuss nutrition in animals. So we are done with nutrition in plants, now we have nutrition in animals. So the main nutrition in animals is heterotrophic nutrition, whereby we say that here the organisms feed on complex food materials obtained from other living organisms. So it comprises of most mammals in heterotrophic nutrition. So the forms of heterotrophic nutrition, or the types of heterotrophic nutrition we have, first of all, we have holozoic nutrition, which mainly means consuming of solid food substances from other organisms. Then we have saprophytism, which is mainly consuming dead decaying matter. Examples, we have the organism Moses. Then we have parasitism, whereby an organism called the parasites feeds on the host and then draws nutrients from it. Then finally we have symbiosis, which means that the two or more organisms benefit from each other by obtaining nutrients from each other. Examples of symbiosis relationship we have for the maize and the beans, which are mainly planted alongside the other. So the holozoic nutrition mainly involves ingestion of food, digestion of the food, absorption of the food, assimilation of the food, which mainly use utilizing the food in your body, and then finally we have digestion. So the organisms under holozoic mode of nutrition are called holozoic organisms. So they are classified according to the type of food they mainly ingest, whereby the classifications we have: the herbivores, which mainly feeds on green plants, or they feed on vegetation. Then we have the carnivores, which mainly feeds on flesh. And then we have omnivores, example, the pig and the human beings, they feed on both vegetation and flesh. So let's look at nutrition in animals. The food by which the animal feeds on dictates the type of teeth that the organism will have. So the types of teeth we have for the mammals, we have incisors. For the incisors are used for biting. We have canines, which are used for tearing the flesh. Then we have the premolars and the molars, which mainly have cusps, and they are used for crushing and grinding the food. So let's look at the different types of teeth we have in organisms. So we have organisms which are heterodonts, whereby this term heterodonts means that the teeth have different sizes and different shapes. So the opposite of heterodont, we have homodonts, whereby it means that these organisms, their size of the teeth and the shape of the teeth is exactly the same. So for example, the organisms under homodonts, we have the reptiles and the amphibians, or fish, whereby the teeth is exactly the same size and the same shape. So in human beings, we have two sets of teeth. So the first set of teeth we have is the milk teeth, which is mainly evident when a newborn is at the infant stage. And then after the milk teeth, we then have the permanent teeth, which now takes the organism or human beings up to their old stages. So let's look at dentition. So what is dentition? So dentition, this is the type of teeth and the arrangement that each has in their teeth. So each dentition is unique to the organism mode of feeding. So let's look at the dental formula which accompanies dentition. So what is the dental formula? So this simply is the description of the number and type of the teeth as how they are arranged inside the mammalian jaw. So it shows the number of each type of teeth in half of the upper and the lower jaw inside the mammalian mouth. So the formula name is mainly represented by I to represent incisors, C to represent canine, PM to represent premolars, and M to represent the molars. Like for example, we have the dog which has the formula as shown, whereby we have I, which is for incisors, 3-3, C, which is 1-1, PM, which is 4-4, and then M to represent the molar, which is 2-3, and then the total teeth is 42. So if you look at this formula, if you add all of these values here, you are going to get 21. So 21 means that it is half of the side of the jaw. So to get the actual number, you calculate or you find the sum of these figures here, then you multiply by 2 to get 42. Let's look at the adaptations to feeding of different organisms, whereby we are going to begin with the herbivores. So we have two types of herbivores, whereby we have the grazers, which mainly feed on grass. Then we have browsers, which mainly feed on the herbs. So for the herbivores, we see that we have a honey pad, and what's the function of the honey pad? The honey pad replaces the front teeth, that is the incisors and the canines, which is mainly used for cutting vegetation or cutting the food that will be taken into the mouth. So we have the diastema, which is a gap. So what's the function of the diastema? We see that it is coming as a gap between the canines and the premolars. So the function of the diastema is to separate the new food that is being taken into the organism from the old food that is on the back of the mouth. Also, the diastema serves the function of turning the food by the tongue. So the premolars and the molars have cusps, and these cusps are used for grinding or crushing the food, whereby we see that the premolars grow throughout the year or grow throughout the lifetime of the organism. This is because they keep wearing off, so they must keep growing. So we see that the herbivore organism also has very powerful jaws. What's the function of the powerful jaw? So the powerful jaw is there so as to be able to facilitate the crushing of the food while between the jaws. So example, we have sheep, which is an example of the herbivore, whereby we see that it has the incisors, we have 0-1, the canines, we have 0-1, and then finally the molars, we have 3-3. Then the total number of teeth inside the sheep organism is 32 teeth. So let's look at the adaptations of the carnivores to their mode of feeding, whereby we'll take, for example, the dog. So it has very sharp incisors for biting, gripping, and stripping of the flesh. So again, the canines are very long and curved and pointed to pierce and tear the flesh. So lastly, let's look at the premolars of the carnivores, whereby we have the premolars and the molars are long and ridged to increase the surface area for crushing and grinding of the food. So also, we see that we have the carnassial teeth. So they are enlarged for cutting flesh. They act as shears or scissors so as to be able to strip through the flesh. They are very strong to crush bones. That's why when you see a dog eating a bone, it eats the bone with the lower teeth. So the teeth of the carnivores have a close roots and small pulp cavity opening to allow nutrients to be able to pass through them. So once these teeth are broken, there is no regrowth of the teeth. It's permanent. So finally, let's look at dentition in omnivores, whereby we see that these are organisms which feed on both vegetation and they feed on both on also flesh. So what are the adaptations of the teeth of the omnivore organism? We see that the incisors are chisel shaped, canines are bluntly pointed, and they are poorly developed as compared to the carnivore organisms. And then the molars and the premolars have cusps to grind and to be able to crush food. So the example of organism here, we say that we have human being, whereby the dentition is that they have incisors, canines, premolars, and molars in the number of incisors having 2-2. Then we have the canines having one on the upper jaw and one on the lower jaw. Then we also have premolars, which by they have 2 on the upper, 2 on the lower, and then lastly we have the molars, which is 3 and 3. So when you calculate the sum of this, you are going to get 16, which is half. Therefore, if you multiply by 2, you are going to get 32, which is the number of teeth for an adult human being. So let's meet on the next class as we look on the external structure and the internal structure of the teeth. Biology.